one of many groups actually that put together a conversation slash dialogue series called The Daily Work of Justice, which is 3 weeks of conversation. And this year's theme, it's our first year doing it, but was actually around the criminal justice system. And so the first week we brought in individuals who had been incarcerated or had family members who were incarcerated. The second week we brought in people who work within the system, so police officers, judges, court interpreters. And the final week we brought in advocates and other nonprofit representatives. And it was really powerful for us to just feel very different energy in the room than some of the really contentious conversations, even though criminal justice has a lot of contentious issues to it. And we weren't talking about politics or the election in particular. Having people come and share their lived experiences around this particular theme without identifying this is what policy I think should happen or not, was a very effective program. People actually showed up, and was something that I have been thinking about as I come back to this call of having had that sort of external dialogue that went well, even if it isn't exactly the same frame. So that's what I'm coming back buzzing around in my head and excited to join this conversation again too.
So Sandra, would you like to check in while Nancy gets settled?
Oh, hold on. I pressed a button. Whoops. Hold on. I'm back.
But we can't see your face. We see one box that says Nancy GG, and then I'm not sure what else we're seeing. We see your hand.
You see my hand. You don't like.
There you go. Now we see. Okay. A little dark, but we can see you. Lovely tree behind you.
You're that's a different person that you're.
Sandra, why don't you go ahead and check in if you're ready?
Okay. Okay. So I come to this. And I'm new to this particular one, but this is an issue that really has a lot of fire for me, and I have a lot of fire for it. And I live in Western New York, and not far from Buffalo, but also while Buffalo is a city and it's urban, I actually live outside. In the country, and I definitely live in Trump land. Which is actually, I feel oddly in a way fortunate because many people, I remember talking to a friend of mine back in the Bay Area saying, I don't know, I feel like we have to bus ourselves somewhere to be able to have conversations. And I'm right in there. So, I do go into Buffalo. I'm a facilitator of a covenant group at church, which is, kind of my foray into dialogue work at this point. I'm looking at there are two things I realize. One is how to bring together locally people who are of similar political persuasion as my own, and how we might discuss and approach and really delve into how conversation might happen, could happen. I almost feel that kind of training beforehand. But that's as well as thinking of, because I do know some people who voted for Trump and have connections to, and you know, have the idea of bringing them into some format that would be comfortable for all concerned. So I think I could probably stop there. No?
Very interesting. Okay, great, Sandra. I'm glad you joined us. So this is the first time you've been on this call?
On this call, yes.
Okay, I recognize you,
sir. I was on a call on concerning climate change before the election, a couple of calls with you, so that's probably why
you recognize
me.
That's why I remember that case. Yeah, thanks. I appreciate it.
Okay.
All right, Nancy, do you want to check in?
Sure.
And I am recording this just so I'll make it available for people who want to kind of keep up with our talks. I put it on the site after we record it. Go ahead, Nancy.
So I'm personally in a good space. There, not only is there a huge amount of organizing and meeting and action and resistance actions and so forth going on everywhere here. We're Santa Cruz is a community of 50,000. Well, the city is 50,000 people. The area is probably twice that. And just hundreds, probably if one were to count 1,000 people at least, have shown up since the election and are very actively involved in a number of increasingly well-organized activities. And a portion of that I have gone out of my way to be involved in are really interested in reconnection. And I hardly know where to start. There's so much going on. This past Sunday, we had a day-long workshop. 60 women and one man showed up for it, just using writing as a tool for going deeper in connecting with feelings and sorting out priorities and commitments. And the woman who ran it, Laura Davis, is the author of Courage to Heal and a number of other well-known books, and has for 20, 30 years now been teaching writing as a mode of dialogue and inner work, as well as actually helping people get published as authors. It was stunningly successful, and we're going to do a series, a week-to-week series, continuing that for a month or two. There are a handful of different groups that have formed as affinity groups and trust circles to do something like maybe what your group is doing, Linda. And I'm also part of a progressive Christian forum here, and we've agreed it's a very left-leaning group, and we've agreed to reach out to friends and colleagues who are ministers and members in conservative fundamentalist and evangelical congregations here in town. And I was up on my high horse with Linda on my soapbox before some of you got on, insisting that the question she had posed, if I may put words in your mouth, Linda, because I think it's a helpful starting point for this conversation. You had said, how do we get conservatives into a dialogue with us? And first of all, let me note that at least half the people here, I think, are planning to get on buses sometime soon and bus over to the closest conservative Republican counties and enter into, but it's unclear, because the one thing that motivates everybody on the left is to learn how to talk nice to people on the right so they can convince people on the right that they're right, that the left is right. And the right might not think the left is right, even if they can be nice and respectful and not as condescending and arrogant as the left often is in dealing, talking about or to people who differ from them politically. So there's that whole thing going on. And it's a very mixed thing. There's also something called swing left. I'm sure you've probably heard of a major effort. There's two different things going on simultaneously that are get out and talk to your neighbors. One is swing left, which is get out to neighbors somewhere else who voted, who did or might have voted for Trump or didn't vote at all, and try to get them on board so that come 2018, the Democrats can take back the House of Representatives. And it's a fairly straightforward political organizing. And I'm emphasizing this because it's really important to sort out these things as we're talking about it, because these are efforts that on the surface can look quite similar, but can be quite different in their purposes and process. And that is pretty standard political canvassing. And then paralleling that is another effort, the knock on every door, which is intended to be go out, talk to your neighbors, ask them questions, and really listen. I think that probably requires more training than is going into it. And some of those involved really mix up the two. For them, knock on every door means get as many people as you can to come over to the left side. But many people are genuinely interested in learning, listening, building connections. And some of that is knock on every door. And others were looking at creating spaces. When I climbed up on my soapbox just now with Linda, I said, from my perspective, if you ask the question, how do we get conservatives to come and talk with us? I would change that and say, can we reach out to leadership within the groups we would like to be in dialogue with? Find leadership that shares the desire for dialogue for their own reasons. Faith communities, the Christian communities in particular, are a really good place to be looking at for that, because what's happening within congregations as well as across the country within denominations are deep. The deep political splits are starting to divide the communities of themselves, the congregations. So leadership in that area have a very strong interest of their own in trying to create dialogue and go deeper. But the general point I'm making is find leaders who have credibility in their own communities, who have also their own strong interest in creating dialogue, and then with them, plan out the rest. With them, create the purpose, figure out the purposes, the framing, the language, the content, the background information, the processes, the invitation, the networking. Then I think we will have much deeper, far better dialogue, and we will have far greater impacts in rebuilding trust and mutual concern and mutual support across these barriers. And I will get off my soapbox and let somebody else talk.
Thanks, Nancy. Thanks for clearing that up. Yeah, I was really having a hard time hearing you, and I like your approach, and I'd like to hear more. And I think the jumping off part, especially with Sandra on the phone, would be interesting. And I think there's probably something there that Virginia can relate to as well with her criminal justice work. So, Paul, why don't you...
Oh, and I'm sorry. Let me just make one quick request.
Sure.
Virginia, if the process you guys went through is either written up, or if I could interview you and we do a little video or something, I'd love to go a little deeper with that and get a sense of what you learned from it, et cetera. Sorry, Paul.
Sure. I'll just clarify that I live in Virginia. My name's Elizabeth.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And I would be
what did I, what
okay.
Did I, call you?
I love where I live too.
What did I call you?
Virginia, which is fine. It's a good state. I would be glad to talk to you afterwards about sort of how we put that together and what it's looking like for sure. So
thank you, Elizabeth.
Well, I think we have time. There's so few of us on the call. I'd like to hear a little bit more too. I'm sorry I didn't get more down. I'm beginning to take some notes. I don't know if you can see here, so we have a written record too. But before we do that, let's hear from Paul. Paul, maybe give us a little bit of your background and let us know what attracted you to dialogue work in the first place and where you are with it.
Well, thank you, Linda. This is the first time I've ever participated in anything like this. I got involved through vocational counseling called LifeWorks Direction. And practitioners, we did all kinds of personality tests and stuff, and listening to my background and the things that I really enjoy that make me passionate. They said, you know, you really should do this LifeWorks Direction stuff. I mean, you should really look into dialogue. And I've always felt like I've been kind of a weird duck. I was born and raised in Midland, Texas. My church, I'm an Episcopalian. Oh. George W. Bush, he grew up behind my church. My brother knows him. I've come from a very Republican background. I've been, before I moved to Massachusetts, I live north of Boston in Gloucester right now. Gloucester, I don't know if you saw the movie Manchester by the Sea. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I live about 3 miles north of where that movie is based out of. But anyway, I moved to Boston to go to seminary, and I studied to be an Episcopal priest at probably the most liberal seminary in the world, the Episcopal Divinity School. Which has a lot of feminist liberation theology studies and stuff. So I come from a very liberal background. I mean, a very conservative background, but I've got a very liberal education as well. And I'm also a petroleum engineer. So I've been involved in oil and gas all my life. My company was the company that developed the slick water fracturing technology that you see everything, all this oil development going on as a result of that. The company was called Mitchell Energy. So I know all about fracture technology. My training at EDS, I really started to, you know, learn about power. And listening to you ladies talk, it's what brings the conservatives to the table. Right now, they, you know, I was just thinking, what incentive do they have because they have all the power? And so the problem is when you've got all the power, why do you want to give up your power? And so... I'm just thinking about that, other than, you know, oh, you know, I'm going to, you know, go and waste my time with good-hearted liberals that want to talk, but, you know, you don't have any power. So I'm just that kind of just looking at that whole dynamic of what incentives you can get to get people to come and talk. Now, looking at the incentives, you know, we all want the same things. We all want to live in a beautiful environment. We all want to have, you know, the freedoms that we have as Americans. And I know living in Boston and north in Massachusetts, I am surrounded by liberals. Although in Gloucester, there's a lot of Trump supporters here. So it's interesting when you see the Trump Pence bumper stickers, you know, some of your visceral reactions when you see a, you know, truck go down the road. So, I'm looking at this and I'm just going, how do you get people to the table other than you just want to talk, which is a good, I want to talk and I want people to understand why it's so important. So now how do I get my family to the table? How do I get my friends in Texas to the table? How do I get my Republican friends that, you know, who lived under, I thought was the absolute best president in my life and who could not stand Barack Obama, you know, and they wanted him out of there. Now they've got Trump and all the facts that all everything that they threw at Obama over the years, they just don't see their hypocrisy. So anyway, it's a frustrating thing where I sit on how do you get, when you care deeply about your country and where you don't want to have another civil war, how do you get people coming in across the divide to talk?
Right.
Anyway, that's kind of where I am. just, I, you know, all I am, just listen. I was listening to, I don't know if you've ever heard of TED Talk.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
But there was a wonderful, somebody had emailed me a wonderful link to this lady used to be a part of the Westboro Baptist Church.
Yes, I've seen it.
And she left that church, and through dialogue, now she's getting involved in dialogue, and she's giving wonderful talks about how, as a conservative, as a fundamentalist conservative, that she got out of this fundamentalist mindset. And it was all because, you know, she was talking and chatting with people online and stuff. And she was listening to other people's truths. So she was able to open her mind and listen to other truths, which, you know, in the church, you might call that, that's a grace-filled moment.
Wow.
You know, or a miracle. But how many people are willing to do that, you know? So
Wow. Anyway,
that's...
That's great.
I can send that link to Linda if anybody would be interested in looking at that.
I'd be very.
So really, it was really a powerful thing.
I read an article in the New York Times Review, oh, I don't know, a month ago or so, about a similar kind of thing. A fellow had been living very close to where Trump lives in his Miami-based place, and felt politically exactly in alignment. He went off to college, and because he got into some sort of liberal, more progressive group of his peers, he completely changed. He just completely shifted, and it just opened him, you know, in ways that he never could have predicted. So it was similar. So that's nice to hear. Great story. Great background, Paul.
I know in my own life, when I came up here to go to seminary, I remember my dad saying, well, why are you going to move up to Massachusetts? You're just going to become one of those damn Yankees. and I told him, well, you know, truth is truth, and we can't be afraid to see, you know, why should we be afraid of what the truth is? And I know through my own experience, you know, through some of my wonderful liberal friends who embraced me up here, you know, and then I started reading things like the New York Times and getting different perspectives on my own. That's when I started to be slowly changed, you know. So I look back at my when I lived in Texas in my own perspective, you know, there wasn't any evil intent. It's just ignorance, you know. You just read, you know, and you know, you see this. You see people just, all they watch is Fox News. You know, my brother, all they watch is Fox News. And I say, well, why don't you get some other kind of perspective? And it's just like, well, why? You know, all they do is lie to you. And I said, well, at least you can go see, you know, and they're not even willing to do that. So it starts becoming frustrating, and then you finally just kind of throw your hands up.
Yeah, I know. In some of our earlier dialogues, we came to the place where we were all living in bubbles. And how do we get out of our little, you know, encased media bubbles? I know I'm the same way. Every once in a while, I'll try to force myself to listen to Fox News. And I can do it for about 20 minutes. And then I realize there's no news there for me, you know. And then I go back to my own sources. So it's a challenge.
Linda, when after Courtney, I want to hear from her. I would love to take a... stab at answering some of the really great questions Paul's been raising.
Absolutely. So Courtney, we're just checking in. We're doing long check-ins, just trying to see where we all are and where we might go from our check-ins in terms of a dialogue.
Okay. Well, sorry I joined you all late. I was talking to some NCDD staff and things ran over. Courtney, I work for the National Coalition for Dialogue and Deliberation. I think I've spoken to most of you at one point or another in these conversations, and I missed the February call, so I'm a little bit behind in how things have progressed. But I think what I've heard in the short time that I've been here has certainly resonated in terms of how do you invite people into those conversations, how do you get dialogue started, and how particularly do we get our more, you know, more conservative folks to the table. I would raise up an example that I've heard about recently that I think is can be, you know, powerful. I mean, this particular example. So anyway, I'll give you the example and then I'll talk more about that. I spoke to Julie Winokur last week. She's a filmmaker, and she made a short documentary, about 40 minutes or so, about her travels going across the country in 2012 to talk to people on all spectrums politically about their views and just listen. Some of you might, Linda, I'm sure you probably heard, she came to the 2014 NCDD conference and actually screened her film, Bring It to the Table. And she and I were just talking recently about where is she now, what has she been doing. She's been kind of taking this film to colleges and universities and also getting the students to sit down and, you know, have a table conversation, so a one-on-one about this is my perspective, here's where I consider myself on the spectrum, liberal or conservative, and here, you know, and talk about a couple of key issues. And that has seemed to be both a good way to invite people in because you're asking them to talk about themselves and what they believe and what their experiences have been, versus inviting them into a conversation that's really trying to dig too deep into, you know, the issues and what we want to see happen. I don't think that's obviously the resolution to all of our issues, but I can see the value in just giving people that opportunity to hear one another, because before I spoke to her, I looked back at some of her conversations that she's had with folks, and you know what really struck me was, regardless of the political leanings, there's such nuance in everyone's perspective and what they believe in, what they think is important, what they value, and why. And oftentimes, there's a lot of experience, you know, life experience that contributes to that perspective, and so just reminding myself personally of the complexity of where we all come out on our views, and that there is, you know, really a value to those experiences that have brought us to this point, but also just the opportunity to be exposed to more viewpoints and really get to understand those might be an essential first step just to even inviting people into dialogue. So that's just a recent, recent thing that I've been contemplating a bit more. You know, I optimally would love to get a group of conservatives and liberals together and really kind of tackle challenges and things we disagree on and things like that. But it seems like just even getting people to the table is hard. I've probably shared this on a call before, but you know, I myself just found recently that with some of my family, my in-laws, who are very conservative, that just inviting the conversation and focusing it more on experience and what they value and why they, you know, why they have those perspectives in light of those values has changed the conversations we've been able to have, which is encouraging because it was in a place where oftentimes I would just kind of keep my mouth shut because I did not want to cause any tension among family members. But when I decided to just kind of invite the conversation and ask them, you know, more questions than give my own commentary, but then of course share some of my perspectives as well. It's really been, you know, enlightening, and it feels like, you know, we can talk about these things now. We might not agree on things, but we can at least have a conversation and we know how to approach it with one another. Which is silly because I've been doing this work for like 13 years and And it took me that long to really just boil it down to, at the basic level, I need to just be curious and, you know, thoughtful and invite the conversation instead of, you know, really getting bogged down in the, what they're saying to me hurts, you know, like that hurts. I can't agree with that. How can they think that kind of feeling? So, so those are some of my recent experiences and things that I've been thinking about in this regard.
Thanks, Courtney. I don't know if you were on the call when I confessed that I completely lost it over the holidays with my very conservative brother's family. And I had to apologize big time. I know this. I know what to do, and I couldn't do it. You know, it's mm-hmm. Well, let's just open it up for dialogue. And I think, Nancy, you had some questions you'd like to lead in with, and we'll just see where our conversation goes.
Actually, I wanted actually to pick up on Paul's questions. I'm going to go back and what we've written down, what would bring conservatives to the table? They have all the power. So why would they come to the table? Why would they want to give up their power? What are the incentives we all want? And then you went on to start maybe exploring possible answers in that we do all want the same things, to live in a good environment and the freedoms we have. The first thing I'll just repeat that it's important that whoever the we is that is trying to bring whoever to the table, that is whoever is doing the convening, ideally we are doing that in partnership with people who have leadership within the communities we're trying to reach and who have their own real desire to make dialogue work. I think that if you can't, if that's not there, it's not there. But if that would be the first step, I think always. And then to sort out the rest of this with them. A second thing I think as to why they would be there, where I've gotten with this is our focus typically at this point is either on trying to reconnect at the relationship level, which is essential. Absolutely. I've said good relationships, good communication is always necessary. It's always fundamental. And as you were saying, Courtney, it always starts by hearing each other's stories and reasons and reconnecting at the level of humans and feelings. And as you were suggesting, Paul, and getting sort of connected around our fundamental commonalities and common needs and aspirations. But I've also said that good conversation is necessary, but rarely sufficient, because there are also real issues that we're grappling with. And I'll comment to you that in my perspective, we are all of us in this country victims of a massive amount of a combined manipulation by political powers and the media's need to keep attracting audiences by promoting infotainment and conflict rather than really trying to connect or inform. And a narrow slice, the research suggests that we actually agree on about 80% of the issues. But you don't win elections. Elections are inherently competitive. You don't win elections on what people agree about. You win them on what people disagree about. And we've been pulled into having our very identities defined by this narrow band of political issues that have been defined by other people. Their political conflicts, whichever side it is, they've been defined through this political process to necessarily be incompatible, in conflict with each other. Again, that's how you win elections. So part of it, I think, is working together to get, in addition, and again, always emphasizing the human element that we're talking about. But once we do shift into the substantive stuff, to get to reframe the issues, to get to the more fundamental questions. So let me give you a concrete example. It is my understanding from Tim Bonneman, whom some of you know, and with whom I'm working, he may be working with Kettering Foundation. I'm fortunate right now forgetting whether it was West Virginia or South Carolina, but the state wanted to open up throughout the state in every a county by county conversations about our economic future. And I want to say, you know, that is a question you can pose anywhere, everywhere. We need to be asking questions for which we don't think we already have the answers. So we are jointly engaged in struggling to deal with fundamental issues that are quite frightening to all of us in their implications. And that particular one actually opens up just about anything else you care to talk about, whether it's climate or justice or economics or new jobs or old jobs or whatever. But trying to find those questions that about the future of our own communities, community resilience, community security and safety, that those are things that we have a common stake in getting good answers to. And most of the good answers are not going to come out of the decisions that politicians make. And I'm not putting that down. I'm a former state bureaucrat. I have enormous respect for what government does at its best. But most of the answers we really need are collective answers where we together start figuring out how to solve our very difficult problems. How do we improve the economics in our situation? How do we prepare for disasters or recover from them, etc.? So I going to your what would bring people to the table, hopefully are questions that we have a shared interest in, and out of our struggles together to solve the problems can emerge agreements, maybe quite naturally, that involve a lot of us in actively working together to solve the problems later. And a piece of which will be formal governmental policies that need to be enacted, but we would be asking or demanding our government to take those actions from a unified position across the what previously have been separated, manipulated into divisions politically. We've come together and are now turning around and saying, okay, this is what we really need you to do. I'm done. Thank you for your patience in letting me speak at such length.
And Nancy, just so you know, I tried to take notes, but please fill in where you can, because I didn't get it all.
Okay.
So, well, that was a lot. I was kind of curious, Tim's working with the Kettering Foundation. Where did you say he's working, and what is it called?
It's just at the earliest stages, Linda. As soon as I have my details correct, I'll get back to you and others. And I'm also not even sure. It was mostly the question that was being posed, that one of those states is going, this is the part I understand. I think they're going to work with Kettering. I'm not sure about that. And the question they want to pose county by county is, what is our economic future?
The reason I was curious was I'm still trying to read, I don't know how many books all at once, and so I haven't gotten very far in this one particular book. But Barbara Simonetti had put me onto a book, I think it's called The Grand New Strategy, which I keep mentioning to people. And there is a section in it in which it gives you great hope, where they go, this one particular firm went into this community, I think it was in the Midwest somewhere, right after a terrible, terrible tornado had hit the community, and the town was devastated. But what this company did was they put up a big white tent, and they invited the community to come in to talk about just that, Nancy, to talk about what does this community need to recreate itself. And they got everybody, well, not everybody, but a lot of the town to come in and to really talk deeply about what they wanted to see in the future. And from there, they were able to actually rebuild their community in ways that brought a lot more jobs. A lot of the young people were leaving the town, going to larger towns. But because there had been so much dialogue and real coming to terms with what wasn't working in the town, they were able to completely redesign and reimagine what they wanted that town to be like. So I think that's in line with what Kettering, this thing.
Exactly. Thank you, that's very exciting.
I can just say, I touched on that even in my group yesterday in Tubac. We started with the question, it was a quite potent question, which was, what are we the most worried about in this administration? I mean, if our worst fears came about, you know, what brings us the most concern? And where the conversation eventually got to was this idea of sort of the transition town. You know, what could we do as a small town? My little artist town here is maybe 2,000 people, 4,000 in the high season, 2,000 year round. So it's of a size where we really could look at our water, our food, you know, the ways that we would sustain ourselves if worse things came to worse. And I think that's how this idea can start to unfold, because I was doing transition town 5-6 years ago, and it didn't take. We weren't quite there yet. But I think maybe the time's coming where these sorts of ideas are, you know, maybe that's what brings us into conversation. I don't know.
You know, the only thing I would slightly spin on it is the notion of resilience, for me, has perhaps the most potential. Transition town, to get into the narrow sense of Ron Hopkins' transition town concept, you had to accept the idea that we were going to hit peak oil and we were necessarily going to quit being so fuel driven, all of which is probably true anyhow, but it's a big hurdle to have to jump over to get to the transition town. But if you simply talk in terms of community resilience, and there's a huge amount of work going on world round, and you can say the research shows communities are most resilient if prior to the disaster, not only did they do what they could to prepare for and prevent disasters, they also built their bonds. They worked together to become more closely bonded as a community, to know where the needs were and be prepared to help each other out, and maybe even have rehearsed it or something. All of these things create a groundwork so that when the disaster happens, you do better in the disaster, and you do a lot better recovering after the disaster. And we should probably mention the book. I don't remember the author's name, but it's called Paradise in Hell. And she's the author of the more recent wonderful book, Hope in the Dark. Both of them really good. And Paradise in Hell is her study, I think, based on 5 years of interviews with, like, in New Orleans and a number of other cities that have shown that in hell, i.e. when things really fall apart, it can bring out the best in people.
That was Rebecca Solnit.
You're nodding away there.
Rebecca Solnit.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Cool. So other thoughts?
So I'd be glad to share a little more about the conversation series we offered, partly because I think it gets to a piece of what I'm hearing from Nancy about the relationship between sort of conversation and sharing experience and policy and decision making that comes out of that. And that's something we continue to talk about with this program, which is, it's called the Daily Work of Justice. And basically what we focus on is bringing in people with lived experience around an issue, or particularly lived experience of a population. So in this year, it was people who in some way were connected to the criminal justice system. So as I mentioned, people who've been incarcerated, and then police officers and lawyers, and then interpreters and nonprofit people. And one of the things that was really beneficial about this was there's lots of policy and decision making that happens around the criminal justice system. But what we found is for many of our participants who we hadn't specifically invited because of their experience, they didn't think about how the criminal justice system was also made up of people. and those experiences. But what the way we modeled this, so we had 10 tables and each table had a facilitator and a guest speaker who had that experience. But our first question to everyone at the table, which had about 8 other participants, was, what is your experience with the criminal justice system? And really probing people to think about, you know, I talked about being in the backseat when my mother got pulled over for a speeding ticket when I was a kid and she didn't get the ticket. That was an experience with the system. It's part of my life. And so hearing from the participants their connection to that and then letting them hear from a police officer what they think about this work. But to get to some of those bigger picture questions, our final question for the night was to the whole group, what does a just community look like to you? Mm. And that functioned really well in terms of both hearing the specific example that a just community looks like for a police officer or for someone who's been to jail, but also the similarities that we think of in terms of justice. One of the things we talked about a lot as a planning group, and that question gets to, is when you start asking the question of what does a just community look like, you want to make that happen, right? That's an ideal. And so we closed the evening with a list of opportunities for action. So whether it was legislation that was coming up around the criminal justice system or nonprofits that we were working with, and not saying here's how you should vote or here's what you should do, but as you think about what a just community looks like and what others have said, here are places to plug into that. So I just offer that it is certainly something we continue to grapple with, not making lived experience and policy work be sort of an either end. They don't have to be in competition with each other, but you do have to think about how do you pull people in and then what are the frames of experience that let people make their own actions around that work. And that question of what does a just community look like was hard for people to get to because they wanted to keep hearing more. You know, they'd never spoken to a judge before, but brought a good closing to it. And it gets me in my last thought, you know, as I've been on a couple of these calls and I find them really valuable and interesting, but a question that comes to me with this group, but also as we think about inviting people with more conservative perspectives, is what do you want to talk about? If it's just come talk about being a conservative, come talk about being a liberal, that's less interesting. That piece, and we talked about this a little bit on the last call of different approaches to that, but one being, what are some less, politicized isn't the right word, but less sort of contentious or highly sparking issues right now that can bring people in? Because otherwise, I'm just a stranger clicking a button and joining in a group that I don't know. So we had one model of that on our campus, but that's not a universal model. It just worked very well for our community.
You said you
I've
do.
Got to leave now, so.
Oh, you have
what
to
did go. You say, Paul?
I said I've got to go now, so thank you for inviting me to the meeting, and I certainly enjoyed it. So I hope you'll invite me again.
Okay, Paul.
Now, Paul, we'd love to hear much more from you next time in response to this, so I really hope you do come back. It'd be great.
Yeah. Okay, well, you know, I know. Anyway. We'll talk again.
All right.
We'll be okay. Thank you all. Bye bye.
Bye bye. Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry. He did have to go. I didn't realize that he had only an hour for the call. I invited him in at the last minute. He was a friend of Bob Staines, Courtney, who suggested that he get in touch with me because he really wants to get into the field of dialogue but doesn't quite know how to do it. So I thought this would be a good experience.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah.
That's great.
So, Elizabeth, I was wanting to know just a little bit more. So who sponsors the daily work of justice? Like, how did that even get started?
Yeah, it happened like many good things do with 3 people going out to lunch. So I work on a college campus, and it was originally a staff member from my office, a faculty member and a college chaplain having a conversation about how do we have more conversations about justice. This was back last summer. And in particular, how do we bring different voices onto our campus and more voices? And then it, when we started, sort of our semester started, we settled on this concept of these three conversations and the theme of criminal justice. And so from there, we started adding in faculty, staff, and community members who had some sort of experience or framework on the criminal justice system. So we had our chief of police on our planning committee. We had faculty members who do work on school to prison pipeline in the committee, local organizers, etc. So it came out of the college broadly, but came from a couple of different people. And as we talk about, we've just started having conversations about what next year will look like. I think we'll use a similar approach of sort of who are the people at the very beginning who will make the logistical decisions of, okay, it's happening in February, and then who will bring a little more of that theory and conceptual work, so that we made sure the 30 or so guest speakers we had over the course of 3 weeks, we found through our personal and social networks, sort of who knows a judge or who knows someone who maybe knows someone who's been incarcerated. And so that was a really powerful experience, but made it important that we had different people on our committee who wouldn't be inviting the same six people with the same six perspectives. So it's an organic group that all have some loose affiliation to the college.
That's an amazing feat. What did you end up doing with all of the material? Did you write it up in some way, or?
So we just wrapped it up 2 weeks ago, and we had our last meeting. So there was a little bit of sort of news coverage of it, and I can send that to you, local news coverage, and I'm glad to share that. We haven't gotten to the reporting out stage. We did have a bit of funding from the college, so we'll have to do some of that reporting out for the cost of, we did sort of renting the tables and the snacks and those kinds of things. We also covered travel for our speakers who were coming in from a couple hours away. So there isn't an official report yet. When there is, I'm glad to share it, but I'll gladly send the sort of link to the news article about the first couple of conversations.
And did I hear you're going to do it again or on another topic?
Yeah, that's our intention, is to do it again in what will be 2018, will be the actual series. We don't know yet what the topic is. We just started having that conversation that got us back to, again, sort of Nancy's point of what the conversation has been about is how do we make this about populations and people instead of policy issues. So it's not come dialogue about gun control or come dialogue about this thing. It is come hear about the experiences of people who are doing the daily work, who have, in this case, had an interaction with the criminal justice system, but it could be any other issue as well.
Really like it. Really like the way you got so many people all around that issue from very different sides.
Yeah.
That's very unique. That's cool.
It was really powerful.
Yeah, I can imagine. Wow. Good idea.
Yeah, I'm really excited by it. And I'm hoping, I don't know whether in the formal report, although I would recommend it be a part of it, but it seems really worthwhile to write this up from the perspective of a template that other people could readily pick up on, identifying even the distinction you made between the initial group who worked up the logistical questions, some of the practical things, and created, yes, this is going to happen. We've covered the basics here, and then bring in the substantive people and give them the role in designing it and all of it. It's very, very exciting.
Thank you. Yeah, one of the things that I found really interesting about it was how many of our participants, and again, I think this speaks to how that lived experience connects, could have been guest speakers in a couple of different nights. So they, you know, were a law enforcement agent, but they also had a sibling who had been incarcerated, or they had a parent who an advocate, and so I think that sort of approach of seeing that we're all connected in these larger systems, and then that sort of broader community aspect of it was great. So I'll be really excited when we've done it a second year and sort of proven the model, but I'll certainly, I appreciate your encouragement to make it a formal thing that we can share.
Yeah, that's really a great model. It reminds me too.
And I love the name. I'd love to steal it and just make it a kind of thing that communities or colleges, the daily work of justice is brilliant. It's a beautiful name. I love it.
And it ties in with what you were doing this morning, Courtney, with what was morning for me around your confab, where you had journalists writing up and sort of leveraging these experiences, these shared experiences. That's so much what we need if we're ever going to knit our fabric, our very fractured fabric together again. People are going to read it. They're going to experience this. It's great.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
What college, Elizabeth?
We're at William & Mary in Williamsburg, Virginia.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So Sandra, why don't you tell us a little bit more about what you're doing in your church and what you'd like to be doing, and maybe we can kind of brainstorm that a little bit.
Well, in the church, there's a, there are small groups of, we call them covenant groups. They're also called small group ministries. So there could be a topic. Often the topic is just presented at the time with some short quotes. And it's an opportunity for people to go deeper together with a smaller group. And it's something that's actually taken off at the church. And we don't have enough facilitators. So I've gotten involved with that. And I'm at the same time as outside in my community, I've got, I'm very involved with a lot of resistance work in a small town, actually a village, which is a real mix of people. It's definitely not a liberal town, but it's an open, and there are historically a lot of artists in this community. So that in and of itself is something that opens things up. And there's a recognition definitely in this village, which has a lot of a rural area around it, that we really have to be openly in conversation with people that definitely may not agree with us in all likelihood. I live in the most conservative congressional district in New York.
Wow.
And our member of Congress prides himself with the fact that he was the first member of Congress to endorse Donald Trump. So this is tough stuff. Very tough stuff. I found what Nancy was saying to be very, some of the things I had already come to in my mind. Other things, such as, reaching out to other church leaders and trying to draw in people for a conversation. That way I thought, that's something I'm going to think about and how to move forward and play with that notion. Because there's certainly plenty of churches around here. However, what's going on inside them, as far as more conservative churches. But I have some ways of perhaps finding out. So that's I hadn't thought of it. That approach.
Well, that brings up the other question for me from what Nancy was talking about. It still seems to me that the topic or the issue would be the way to lead. I mean, in other words, I wouldn't know exactly how to reach out to other groups and group leaders, Nancy, unless I had a topic in mind. Then that would be suggestive of who I might reach out to. Does that make sense?
Well, let me just tell you, Linda, in practice, what we're doing is reaching out ideally to people that you have some sort of other connection with already. So there's a bit of a relationship there. And finding those of us, you know, and then having it as open as possible and basically saying, you know, there's this divide going on. We're concerned about it. How do you see it? How do you feel about it? What's coming up for you or your community around this divide or around what's happening politically? Or it could be in another context. Let me shift and say in another context. I do want to keep making the distinction. I'm going to distinguish between starting with the question related to the divide, which is what we're doing right now in Santa Cruz. And it's partly, depending on who you're talking with, looking at the political divide, or it can be looking at the religious divide itself. As one of the people in my group said, I would just like a conversation. I'd like to invite them to have a conversation. What is your personal experience with God? And just get around the differences between the creeds and the beliefs and the things that separate the churches, and take it to, as Courtney was saying, and Elizabeth, take it to the level of what are people's experiences. In this case, they would be starting with spiritual experiences as a starting point for some of the groups. In another case, I spoke briefly to a man who's very involved in climate work in the Citizens Climate Lobby that I'm part of here in Santa Cruz. And I know that he's a member of our largest fundamentalist church in town. And he had gone to his minister to talk about climate issues and was pleasantly surprised to find that his minister was quite supportive. So I already knew that about him. So I had like a 3-minute conversation with him the other day. I said, hey, Mark, you know, we're talking about trying to do this, and we want to just get together some people, some leaders from the different perspectives, and talk out what we might do together and how it might work. So we were keeping it all very, very loose. And the way my group originally set it up, they said, just talk to folks, you know, and then come back next month and we'll tell each other what we learned. And then we'll figure out where we go from there. However, several of the people we've talked to are already so interested that we might shift that and actually have them be at that next meeting and kickstart that original conversation. I want to distinguish that from the other approach that I'm intrigued by with what's going on in Virginia, where you don't actually start the conversation about the differences or politics per se at all. You start with a question that is of such obvious fundamental concern to a community and its leadership, such as our economic future or our resilience or how we would deal with a disaster, that everybody's on board to begin with. And it may or may not ever show up that you've got political differences, because they're only relevant when you're forced to buy into these contentious framings that were done elsewhere by other people for their own political purposes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. Good point.
For me, good point. Kind of goes down to, or goes back to, what makes a good dialogue a good dialogue. It's that we're dealing with something that's emergent. We're dealing with something in the group that has enough pull to get people there. And then in some sense, the difference, the different perspectives, as long as we allow people to share their stories, their lived experience, I like that term a lot, Elizabeth, then we're simply giving life experiences to what's bringing us together. And that we don't have that contentiousness right from the beginning, you know. I noticed in our dialogue last month with Steve and Scott, Scott Wagner, he wrote the book, A Liberal's Guide to Conservatives. And they both talked in the very beginning of our dialogue on the different perspectives based on empathy or around empathy. And for me, that didn't feel emergent enough. In other words, I don't walk around and wonder, you know, how are my views different from those on the conservative side around empathy. But what I did learn, it was very interesting, and I learned a lot of this actually after the dialogue, I'll share with you, because Steve sent off some documents that I believe I did post on the this Keep It Chat site. He gave an example of how it is for conservatives sometimes in our culture, because at least according to what he sent me, what was being written, they often feel that our entire culture, our mainstream dominant culture, is much more liberal. And so they're constantly feeling beaten up by the liberal press. That's why they don't particularly want to come to dialogues that have a lot of liberals, because they feel like they feel that liberals look down on them, feel that they're stupid, feel that they're less than. And I can totally see that, you know, a challenge. So how I came out of that dialogue last month was, wow, I don't want to particularly deal with abstract issues like empathy. I'd rather get into some emergent issue that we can explore, you know, our stories around, you know, how did we come to the views we hold on a particular issue that we all know that's up for us. So I think, I don't know, that's kind of where I am in terms of moving this group forward.
So I'll share that one of the things I committed to for 2017 was to have some dinner dialogue sort of in my personal life. And it's been a question of what will those themes be? And thanks in part to the listserv, sort of got reacquainted with conversation cafes and went back and looked at those questions and found them to be, interestingly, particularly the questions that come out sort of around 9/11, right? Another time of national intense emotion, a different kind of unity versus disunity, but some strong pieces there. So the first dialogue that I hosted 2 weeks ago, the questions were all about freedom and just asking people, sort of the opener was, when have you felt most free? And then the next question was about sort of what do you need to feel free and what are you willing to give up? And I found that and some other questions in Conversation Cafe to get to, it's not policy, although you can get there from like, what do you need to feel free? But it does feel critically important. And I make some assumptions about how those questions, both we had some really similar answers despite political differences, because sort of that general sense of freedom, but also that some of those political differences come up in what do you think of around those. So I would just put an unnecessary plug in to go back to those Conversation Cafe questions from the early 2000s that, to your point, get to some of those pressing but not overly, not where we know what the answer is going to be. Like, I want this and you want that done, but sort of how do we think about these critical issues that lead to us making political decisions.
So that would kind of lead back to the value of going out, digging deep into issues like empathy. Is that what you're suggesting?
Yeah, I mean, what I was hearing you say, Linda, was that empathy is sort of so abstract that hearing perspectives on it is interesting but doesn't lead to action. But I think there is sort of a middle ground where it is about sort of concepts or bigger questions. Again, we've talked about, you know, how would you respond to a natural disaster or your economy, where you might, I would be hard for me to answer what is my lived experience of empathy, even though empathy is a part of my life, but my lived experience of when did I feel free or when did I, what do I want for my economy? Like, what are those middle questions along the way that require my politics to be engaged, but don't require me to answer as a political agent, to some extent. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It sounds like value-based, I mean, really what you're talking about is value-based conversations. So mm-hmm. let's talk about freedom. Let's talk about safety, you know, justice. Mm-hmm. What do those things mean to us? You know, what have our experiences with them been? I mean, that's what comes up for me, which is a little less abstract than something like empathy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It isn't as specific as talking about some political issues where you get mired in the you know, the soundbite type. This is, you know, I think we should do this, I think we should do that, and we just start to butt heads. Because it is, we can all agree that, you know, freedom or justice are important values, but mm-hmm. how we might look at them, what our experiences have been with them, how we might prioritize them in different situations would vary. I could see that being an interesting conversation.
I think particularly when the sort of the next question becomes, okay, so we've identified those, how have you acted based on that value? And then sort of it moves us forward. But yes, that language of value base is helpful. Thanks for adding that in.
Yeah, something like maybe loyalty would be an interesting one, coming from both sides. How does that play out in our lives?
I want to throw in two other concepts that may help in thinking about this. You may, from two sources, getting to yes and NVC. In getting to yes, are all of you familiar with that book?
Mm-hmm.
So, as you know, it's essentially interest-based rather than position-based negotiation. And in nonviolent communication, one of the core concepts is trying to get down to the underlying needs, mm-hmm. the unmet needs, and not get too hung up in how obnoxiously people may initially express their unmet needs. And also I'm thinking of when I sat in on a couple of NIF national issues forums. They're structured, as you know, to take a big issue like criminal justice and then have three, sometimes four, positions developed. And then people look at these positions and they maybe watch a video about it and then talk about what's coming up in the different positions. That's a positional approach. But it takes you down to some of the core issues. What comes up, what is helpful to me is if I think of what we're engaged in initially and fundamentally is a problem-solving process, not yet a policy-making process or an issue resolution, but a problem-solving process. And we look at problem-solving and design processes and agenda setting and who even sees it as a problem and how does the problem get framed in the first place. But the important thing in a design process is to create the design specifications or the system requirements. And so a lot of what we get from diversity, if we go to people's stories, their experiences and their needs, what we can harvest from that, and the more diverse, the more 360 degrees our perspectives are, the better. As people are naming these things, we can be saying, oh, a solution would have to do X. A solution would have to be sustainable. It would have to meet the basic needs of everybody. It would have whatever. And you identify those, it's what you're distilling out of people's stories And then you can often reach common ground or agreement that, yes, ideally, a real solution to our problem of making ourselves, let's say, more resilient as a community or meeting our economic needs. These are the things it would do. This is what it would accomplish. This is the needs that it would meet. And that is a way of making a very constructive result out of the many differences without people yet having to reach any agreement except to agree to take into account all the needs they've heard about from different people, all the interests or fears or concerns or gifts or opportunities or experiences. It's not just the negative stuff that we're bringing in our diversity. We're also bringing different gifts and different ways of contributing. I'll stop. So, excuse me. And then the last point then, of course, and the point of that is you can then have many, many different designs, many different possible actual solutions that meet those different criteria or standards that you've set up. And then you get into researching, finding out who's done what else. That's the other thing we haven't mentioned yet. I would focus, if we're talking at all about problems, I would focus a lot on bringing in videos and stories of the most exciting, promising proofs of concept, new ways of doing things to be found anywhere in the world, like really great examples of collaborative problem solving, community policing that is based on neighborhood collaborative problem solving, where the citizens sit down and work with their police together to identify the problems and agree on their shared efforts to solve those problems, not just putting it on the police. Or looking at how the prisons in Norway work or something, so that we can really stretch our imaginations and it can inspire hope and give some guidance as to where we might want to go.
Well, that brings up questions again for you, Elizabeth, that I have. How did you focus your topic? Like in the beginning, what were some of the key questions, I guess, that you were focused on?
For daily work of justice or at my dining room table?
Well, I guess either, but I was primarily thinking in your justice work.
Sure. So that was, again, sort of a collaborative process to come up with those questions. And it was based on a committee of people who had some experience with the criminal justice system and then had some sort of framing to facilitation. And so in terms of making the questions, we basically divided it into a couple of sections where we did introductions where everyone shared their experience with the criminal justice system and gave particular time for people who are guest speakers to share. And then we had a couple of opening questions that we came up with as a committee that we wanted to make sure got addressed. So we asked something that varied from week to week based on sort of what did your work in the criminal justice system versus your experience? What assumptions did people make about you, et cetera? What we asked specifically, because identity was important to us, about how they experienced race, gender, and other identifiers playing a role. But then really what we did was we came up with some middle section questions. But as many of you know, what happened was instead the people at the table started having conversations instead. So we had sort of these backup questions that were things like, what was your sense of safety in this experience? Or I don't have the question there on the work computer. LEG, so how quickly they paid for all the months we spent on them.
Your lived experience. You didn't have any.
Right.
You weren't trying to solve a problem. It was more just getting.
Nope.
Yeah. Okay.
Exactly. So we were really explicit that sort of the first three quarters of the session, one of the rules of our conversation and one of the things that the facilitators would say at the beginning, probably the rule we'll have to use the most often, although people stuck to this pretty well, was coming back to your lived experience. So, for example, in one of the first conversations I was facilitating, they really wanted to talk about Michelle Alexander's book. And that's a really great and important book, The New Jim Crow. But they were wanting to cite all of these facts. And then we had to sort of say, those are important. Are those facts things that you lived out? Can you talk about how you've seen race be a factor in policing or the criminal justice system? So yeah, the sort of first three quarters were all questions about what's your experience, both as a guest speaker and then a participant. And then we said really explicitly, we're asking you, the group, to do a tone shift here. And we want to talk about what does a just community look like to you, and making that shift from experience to, based on that experience, what do you imagine? And then we did a sort of closing, what's a word or phrase to encapsulate and share that out with a large group. But yeah, all of our questions were, for that first three quarters, were how have you experienced this? And then often having students or other participants say, whoa, that's so different than my experience. Or can you tell me more? I would have never imagined that a police officer would have thought about that or done that.
Interesting. Yeah, that's a really nice approach to just start with lived experience, so that you're not starting with any particular issue so much as just, let's just talk about what this means to any of us.
Yeah, and it was so, you know, again, we start with that question for everyone at the table of what's your experience with the criminal justice system, and most of them would say, I don't have that much. And then as the guest speakers would talk about their experience within the system, people at the table would think, wait a minute, actually, I have a brother who got in trouble in high school and talked to the school resource officer, or I have, I forgot about, you know, the fact that my dad is this, and I didn't think of that in that system. So while we were, I think sometimes participants were worried that a focus on lived experience would mean they didn't have anything to contribute, they found that they did indeed have experience to bring to the table for the most part.
You know, when you're talking about it, Elizabeth, I part of what is so powerful in what you're telling and so precious is, at one level, it's very simple. Very easy for people to get it. And at another level, the thought that you and others put into designing it is really subtle. And it's also really important. Your sense of just exactly when people go off, when they start getting into positional or factual or books or whatever, how do you gently pull them back? And if they're not sure what to say, how do you deal with that? And if contentions start, I mean, there's a whole lot of things that you're ready if it arises. You know how to do it. And the success of the process indicates how well that worked. And there may indeed be a few of the negative learnings. There may be a few places where you said, whoops. You know, who wouldn't do that next time? You know? But the more fully that gets laid out to someone who wants to pick it up and run with it, the better. It's also a way, I might say, you know, we all have this in this field, this meta issue of how do you get other people to really appreciate the power of good process? Years ago, I read a wonderful short interview with one of my very favorite actresses, who, alas, I cannot remember her name right now, but she said, well, good acting is like good housework. You don't notice it when it's well done. You only notice it when it isn't. And good process work is hidden. It works because nobody's even noticing that it's working. But to make explicit those subtleties, I think, will both give better guidance to people who, if they just picked up the headliners and tried to run with them, might get in trouble. And it also helps elevate the awareness, the understanding of just what goes into really good process. And the better it is, the simpler it looks.
So I'm just noticing the time, and I'm wanting to have some kind of sense of where we might like to take this dialogue or not. Into next month. And I'm kind of wondering, Courtney, from your point of view, you're kind of aware of, you know, the needs in the organization. You probably pay intense attention to the listserv. I can only look at it so much. I'm finding it's, I love the listserv.
It can be overwhelming for sure.
It is overwhelming. And I'm noticing some interesting threads that have developed, but I'm just wondering from your point of view, how could this particular dialogue about the post-election impact on our field, how, where would you, you know, sense it might go?
That's a good question. I mean, I think there's what I've been finding in just my own conversations lately with folks, as well as what I'm seeing on the listserv, is a lot of people have been grappling with this idea of is dialogue, people have been saying, is dialogue under threat or is dialogue under assault? Mm-hmm. I wouldn't characterize it that way. I've been saying more, it feels a bit like the unpopular option right now. And so it's feels a bit like an uphill battle to get more people to engage than perhaps it's felt like in the past. And I think there's a lingering conversation that needs to be had in our field about just, you know, how do we reconcile that, and what does that mean for us as we move forward as a field? Do we need to be, you know, how do we? I don't want to use like all the words that keep coming to mind, or so, you know, like how do we combat this negativity around, you know, dialogue? And that's not exactly what I mean, but
yeah,
I think
Courtney, could you say a little bit more about the negativity? What's it look like? Where's it coming from? What's the kind of feedback you're getting that suggests that to you, et cetera?
Sure. So some people, and this isn't just, you know, my experience, but I've been talking with others. I mean, there's been, I think initially there was a personal kind of struggle and reflection for some folks. I've heard a lot of people, we've talked about how for them, particularly shortly after the election, they had a time where they were trying to decide if the work they were doing was really relevant and important and what they should be doing right now. And I think that for them, predominantly as liberals who were very concerned about some of the actions that were being taken, I think they struggled with, should I be continuing to serve in a neutral or impartial type role, or should I be leaning more towards activism? You know, should I be getting people to dialogue about issues and try to resolve things that way, or should I be out marching in the streets? Can I do both? And I've had some folks, you know, conversations with folks who have kind of reconciled, over time have reconciled that, and they're kind of finding ways to serve both desires that they have right now. But on a broader, view, I think for a lot of other people out there who may not be as, you know, exposed to the type of dialogue that we all are convening, the thought is that do they really want to be a part of a conversation with the other right now?
Right.
There's that kind of that things feel so so divided and so strong that there's a lot of, you know, it feels almost like it's not enough to come together. Like we need to do something more. We need our voices to be louder, and therefore, you know, I'm going to continue to go march. I'm going to, you know, like I'm going to go make noise because, you know, that's what I think I need to do. Am I saying, you know, make noise and march and all that is not diminishing any of it. I see the value of it, but dialogue is not necessarily something that they're feeling like is the best thing to do right now. So it's taking a little more convincing to get people to engage with one another than it felt like it was before. And so how do we address that? And, you know, who's succeeding at being able to convince people to do that? You know, what are they doing that's different from, you know, what others have been doing? Like, some of that has been a conversation I've been starting to have with folks, but I think a broader conversation also needs to happen to learn from one another about, you know, how has that experience been? And if you're finding struggle with it, are you able to get past that? And what's been the how have you been able to achieve it? My own theory is probably the more localized the conversation, the more success they're having right now. I think when we look at things on a national scale, that's where it's really hard, because it's just daunting right now to think about how can, you know, folks on either side, but really it's more complex than that. You know, there's a lot of really strong concerns, fears, anger, etc. And, you know, how do we even have a conversation about things on a national scale right now? I think that's where the true challenge is. There's a lot. There's a lot of nuance and different threads within that, but that seems to be what people are really kind of struggling with right now.
But I didn't want to derail you, because you were actually in the middle of making another point when I asked you to give more information on that. So,
well, I think generally that's pretty in line. I mean, I think what I was getting at was certainly it's something that NCDD as an organization is kind of talking about internally. You know, what does it mean for us right now as an organization? And partly for us too, it's, you know, we've always, you know, existed as this organization that supports this network of folks doing this work. Is that still the best thing we can do right now to continue to keep everyone in communication with one another and give that space and provide those resources? Or should we be doing more of like what we are doing right now with the American Library Association, trying to make more inroads to others out there who can continue to, you know, spread the use of dialogue? Libraries, for instance, to me are a very neutral space, great space to incorporate dialogue. And so, you know, is it more our role to help make those inroads and connections so that our field kind of grows through connecting to other, you know, other fields and others doing work in other areas where dialogue can intersect? That I don't think was the point I was going to make. I think the point I was going to make within that was, you know, that seems like a larger conversation for the network to be having too, is how do we, where are we right now? Where do we need to go? And what's the best road for, like, how can we all work together to, you know, to get there?
So I want to build on both your question and Linda's, or your thoughts and Linda's question, about perhaps where we might go, at least in our next conversation. We've been talking about, it's still very valuable, and it's an ongoing thread of how would we have conversations that bridge the chasm, and why would we have them? And we've talked a lot about that today. But what comes up for me when you're speaking, one of the images I use and others, you know, from Joanna Macy's work, The Great Turning, where the images, you know, she uses the hand gestures are this, which is the work of resistance. Mm-hmm. And this, which is the work of reconnection. Mm-hmm. And this, which is, I tend to call it the work of reshaping or rebuilding, redesigning, actually solving the problems. Mm-hmm. And all three are needed, and different people are called to different parts of it. But the appreciation of and the interaction, doing any one of them in such a way that it draws upon and supports the other two. And to recognize we are playing the long game. The best part of what's happening right now is that this kind of chaos is, in terms of both history and systems theory, it's only in this kind of chaos that you get changes deep enough, mm-hmm, to possibly solve the real problems. I mean, we've been locked in, regardless, Democrat, Republican, whoever, we've been locked into non-solutions forever as things get worse and worse. So the very shaking up, if we can somehow make the best of it. And that's the long game. And the third point I'll make is those countries, historically, when really deep change has managed to occur across the society, most of the people in the society end up buying into it. And they buy into it because of these deeper questions and because they start trusting each other. So even if our long game concern is to actually turn around the things that we're out in the streets protesting about right now, eventually our way there is through exactly the kind of work NCD does. And lastly, I'll say I'm thrilled with what you're doing with libraries. And I would urge NCDD to make a major part of your future to look at, like, the American Institute of Architects, city planners, local officials, those folks that have a natural day-to-day need for your skills. And you already know that, but I'm just saying explicit, by all means, I think the greatest weakness of NCDD is we simply are way too ingrown.
Mm-hmm. No, I think that's a good point, Nancy. And that's been something I've been thinking about a bit in terms of where should NCDD go next. And I think that's a big part of it is we need to make more inroads to others who can, maybe they wouldn't be defining themselves, you know, as a dialogue and deliberation practitioner, but they can, you know, their work can greatly benefit
their
from
it. Their work requires it. And each of those settings creates, going back to Elizabeth saying, they create natural contexts for real conversations about things that the people involved have a stake in. And they're not brought together because of the politics.
Well, so I'm wondering if this group might be at its end, or if the one thing that I guess that occurs to me is to kind of use Elizabeth's approach around lived experience, but to bring more, to have this group perhaps next time, if we want to continue this, to simply be a container where we're talking about our own lived experience right now during this time and what seems to be working for us. You know, rather than just talking about how we get across the political divide, maybe we just want to hear more of our stories of what is working, you know, because this is a time of chaos. The one thing that hit me this weekend, I attended the Tubac Book Festival, which is an annual event here, and it's very well attended, and lots of amazing speakers with really good books were there. And Maureen Dowd, who's a commentator with The Times, was there, and I attended one of her lectures, and she said, look, one of the worst things, or one of the better things that has come out of this election is that people are awake. You know, we kind of all, we went to sleep in 2008. We just went like this, and we said, our work's done. We can kind of sit back on our laurels. No worries. Well, that didn't work so well, did it, in 2016. But she said the beauty is we have not been this awake since the 60s and the Vietnam War. So how do we as a field begin to find our own way? You know, we all have slightly different focuses, whether they be more academic like Elizabeth or more community-based such as work Nancy and Sandra and I are doing. But maybe what we need to do is just say, hey, we are in a moment of chaos. We don't know which particular direction we're going in, but let's share our experiences, our own lived experiences, to see if there are some trends that might fall out of just simply coming together and continuing the conversation. How does that sound?
Sounds good.
I know several people here in town that I think might well be happy to show up in this call because that's just where they're at.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think we're all wrestling. You hit it, Courtney, on the head when you said, should I be spending more time organizing or should I, you know, be spending more time in dialogue? I ask myself that every day. And I am doing some organizing. There's a group here that's just nonstop, you know, writing letters and all that. But I kind of felt that I needed to step back because that's not what I felt was my best gift to the community. So I started this community forum. And a lot of people are just thanking me because while we're all doing some of this other work, to have a place where we can come and really share, you know, the fear and the turmoil and all that's going on is tremendously valuable. So I think
I would second that.
Yeah.
I would second that, Linda. Yeah. I mean, I have the same experience of, okay, I'll write the letters, I'll write my congressman, I'll go out and protest. I need to do a certain amount of that, but it's also perhaps my age. I feel this is not my the best thing I can do. My, you know, not just for me, but, you know, I'm looking for what is my most meaningful contribution. And also where I want to be and what I want to learn.
Right.
That's.
I have to confess too that I'm not feeling it so strongly now, but for several weeks, I was feeling a huge amount of emotion and fear. And the fear I was feeling was not about Trump and his followers. It was about the potential there with the kind of inner protest energy that's emerging. It can energize the constructive changes we need, but it could also energize a lot of very destructive things mm-hmm. that would only make things worse. And that really just scares me in the pit of my stomach. So this work is essential to even making the protest and resistance work be part of the solution.
I always say it's about cultivating the soil so yes. that healthy can grow.
Here.
So, I'm sorry, I just noticed that we've got like 2 minutes. So why don't we just do one quick checkout round, anything that you'd like to offer as a takeaway, and we'll close. And I think just any takeaways you'd like to share.
Mm-hmm. Sure. I would just add to what Nancy and Sandra were just saying. I mean, to me, it's, I'm looking at the long road ahead. Nancy, you said the long road earlier. And when I think about the long road ahead, the work that we do is so essential to that. You know, if we ever want to be able to work, you know, together across differences and things like that. And ever, I mean, the idealist in me would like to see a time, you know, in the future where we don't have to feel as dissatisfied as frequently as we do. No matter what perspective you take, you know, that's, I've come to find that tends to just be my feelings about our politics in general, is most of the time I'm dissatisfied no matter what the outcome is, to some level. And I don't think I'm alone in that. And so I think when I think of the long road, I think there has to be some, we have to do more to bring people together to hopefully find ourselves in a place where we get closer to that, you know, level of a greater level of satisfaction, even if our candidate or our policy that we were promoting or what have you doesn't, you know, get passed or doesn't get elected. So I just wanted to add that in.
Thank you.
Elizabeth, any last thoughts, takeaways?
Yeah, one thing that has stuck with me sort of this whole year is about knowing thy neighbor. And no matter the politics or policies, my neighbors are my neighbors. And in my case, they have a variety of political views. And so I really like that this online space has been a place for me to get to know my neighbors as neighbors in dialogue, even though we are in different places. So a closing thought is that it appeals to me to continue this conversation as a space to talk about how are we engaging in dialogue within this climate, even if instead of, or perhaps in addition to, the work we're doing to engage in dialogue, sort of just that knowing of each other's work seems valuable to me.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Sandra, any last thoughts?
Fascinating and a very enriching conversation for me. I mean, I was feeling like a sponge, and there was a lot of resonance also, and, you know, new ways of looking at things, which I really appreciate. And one thing, one takeaway I have is how crucial the human to human connection is in all this. And I think the more we really look at working at that, you know, the more meaning the work will have. And also, I think it will help with the negativity question. Overcoming some of the issues that we have and being able to set that, some of that stuff aside, at least on a human to human basis.
Great, lovely. So, Nancy, last thoughts.
I'm very grateful to you, Linda, you personally, for keeping this thing going. And I want to support you in keeping it going. And I'm also grateful to everyone else because I did an exceptional amount of talking today. And it was very satisfying to me to be able to get it out. But I also felt I was taking up more than my fair share of the airspace. So I appreciate your patience with me in doing that.
Thanks, Nancy. Well, thank you, Nancy, for encouraging me to keep this group going. I wondered where we were going, but I trusted the process, as I've learned to do. And I trusted the right people would show up, which you all were, and we would figure it out. And I think we will be on for a month from today. I'll put that out in an announcement on the site, so you'll get it in the weekly updates. And I will put the recording out, of course. And you can always go back to the notes. They're always left here in Kiko Chat. So thank you, everybody. It was wonderful. Really enjoyed it. Thank you so much from all of you.
Bye-bye.
See you next month.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Yes, indeed.
Take care.